seconds in lane now without a Ver. That's going to be pretty important, actually. I mean, the reason you put Silibear up top is because he has a Ver. If he doesn't
and
have a Ver...
you usually use that Ver to do this pulling from that...
Yeah,
behind,
allow you to get a decent amount of early farm. So without that Ver, he's a pretty terrible solo. You know?
he's not going to do Jack. I think that's the word you're looking for.
He's ranged, but that's about it.
Nexus is going to be playing the Shadow Demon. Venomancer being handled by WeGod. And on the bot here, we have... Sado on that long lane once again. So yeah, let's see how Solera is gonna be playing this the hardest lane in my opinion. And now he has a hero that's not very capable of playing that lane.
I mean, this is an impossible lane for him, right? He's against a Venomancer and an Anti-Mage, and he has no Bear. Like just say that out loud. It sounds ridiculous. He's got no chance. Well, in fact, very wisely, he's gonna stand.
He's
by
just
the
gonna wait a minute.
He's gonna wait it out.
He's gonna wait a minute until his Bear comes on. Meanwhile, Pain to go in the mid lane is going to have a little bit of issue as well. So CRZ could easily take...
through Axes.
Yeah, he threw his Axes. CRZ could easily take Kossika too and just blow the hell out of Pain to go. Now, he might be very safe with the Sandstorm as he doesn't want to push the lane needlessly, I suppose. So, but right now, with the laning and how it worked out, I feel like Quantic's already in a back foot.
Yeah, Z Nation has very strong lanes on top and middle. Now, the one saving grace for Quantic is Korok, their star Morphling player, does have a free lane on bottom to farm. So that's, it's not all peaches and cream for Z Nation right now. They do have a potential problem on the bottom lane that they will eventually need to deal with. But until that point comes, your Anti-Mage is going to get a bunch of farm on top. Middle lane is going to be pretty fat. CRZ potentially with a quick Arcane's Blink Dagger. You get that quick enough on an SK, you can kill anybody. It doesn't matter how tanky Morphling is, he will die.
Yeah, Burrow Strike, the reliability that's then really is low until you get the Blink, and suddenly you're seeing a lot of 2 or 3 in Burrow Strike. We are going to see the initiation
here.
On the mid lane, Pain to go half HP at this point. Here comes a Tornado from the Chen, and that slow might have just been enough, and it's chasing against Nexus. Nexus might just go down. No, he runs barely outside range. We're looking for a Test of Faith on the Last Hit Magic. Not going to get the Last Hit off. Pain to go, though. He is saving for his bottle. He's got it. Ooh, that gank, he survived. And that, he's thanking his lucky stars.
And in fact, Last Hit Magic had a smoke there that I think he could have popped to actually catch up to Nexus and got that last hit, but he opted
not
to do so.
I'm not sure about that one.
I think he might have caught there. I mean, maybe it needed 2 attacks. It probably needed 2 attacks.
Yeah.
That said, opted not to do that. Mikey, meanwhile, on bottom, he does have a set of Sentry Wards that he has placed. One of them, just trying to spot out any wards, but they have put no counter wards there, so he is able to pull relatively easily there. Sand King, meanwhile, with that quick bottle, has got himself a region runes, I believe. Did he just rush a bottle? I think he bought the...
Sand King just rushed a bottle. Not surprising at all. Sand King, one of the more explosive ganker. I feel like Sand King, especially in public games, not to say that this is one, but he could easily dominate lanes. He just roams so well off the mid with runes and teleport scrolls that he could dominate a game very, very easily.
Yeah, he doesn't really get the respect in lane that he deserves from a lot of players. I think most pro teams fully understand just how powerful he is in the laning phase, but I think your average viewer or your average player isn't really going to understand just how incredibly strong he is. It's similar to like a tiny solo middle. Until you actually see it and really understand, then you're like, oh, I get it. Okay, that's pretty ridiculous. It's a very similar aspect. Now, meanwhile, Quantic, Last Hit Magic, and Mikey are on the backside here. Korok there, they want to get Sadoi, but Sadoi just wind runs away the other way. He's not going to run down the tower. Or run down the river here, and they're just going to get nothing off of it. But perhaps this will buy him enough time to get the tower, and that is potentially a deal here, as they do have that Chen there with the Dark Troll Warlord. But I think Sador's going to make it around there, and that tower's going to be fine.
Well, there's a Siege Tower coming in, and that's doing a little damage. Nice power shot. Nice using of the Chen creep, though, pulling people away. I think he's going to keep running to the left. Sure, he might lose that creep, but that's nice. Now, meanwhile, the gank coming on the mid lane, though. Shadow Demon Disruption, Soul Catcher, Burrow Strike, couple of right clicks. That was all they need. My attention was on that bot tower. And speaking of that bot tower, it will be destroyed. That was a Ring of Poseidon push. The question is, will Sadoi get this last hit? Tower focusing on Korok. And that's going to allow Chen to pick up the last hit. Well, better have your Chen to pick it up than no one to pick it up.
Yeah, and I think Chen, they were trying to leave that for Korok, but he didn't actually hit it.
Yeah.
And, Chen was like, well, you're taking a bunch of damage. I'm just going to go ahead and hit this thing. So he ended up taking the tower down. I think they would have liked to have given that to Morphling, to be honest.
I feel like Korok's, he done the right thing. He chased away the windrunner and made sure that his team got it. Sure, himself didn't get it, but that's absolutely fine. And now, as a windrunner, losing an early tower like this, morally you're distraught. and physically you have nowhere to go. Like there's no safe haven. And of course, if you're busting out jukes of the sentry every 2 seconds, like Sadoi's been doing, then you're okay. As that juke just totally blindsided Quantic, kind of.
They didn't expect him to just run straight into him, right?
Yeah, whatever.
I'll run right past you then and go the other direction. Yeah. That said, Last Hit Magic did a very nice job using that chain creep to pull the wave away and allowed them to get that tower. So a quick early tower here from Quantic is going to be pretty beneficial. And, I mean, really, the big beneficiary here is Painted Gold in middle, who did get annihilated. But now, with that tower, now has got himself a bottle and another 260 gold. So he's going to be pretty close to some boots. He can spam a couple axes here and get those boots a little bit faster than he otherwise would have, which should, theoretically, allow him to survive a little longer. Now, the problem is Shadow Demon's... Amplified damage, or Soul Catcher rather, is so strong, coupled with the Burrow Strike, that it's probably still going to be difficult for him to survive.
Okay, Juke Party Part 2, Sadoi featuring him. Here we go.
All right. Oh, you ran the wrong way this time.
Well,
he's going to get frostbitten. We're going to see a Chin just run that creep.
He's running! Yes, he's going to take a hit. He's going to south. He's going to tango. No! The rain creep says, yo, bro! Oh my god, he's going to get a Tesla fave. I think that's the wrong direction now, but. Well played. Nice try.
He tried to salve up, but that range creep was having none of it. He says, how dare you salve on my watch. Now, through all this, Ace Mage is getting a little bit of free farm up top. He's got 900 gold. Of course, the bear is now back alive. He's got himself an orb of venom. Also getting a little bit harassed himself, trying to keep him off the lane. But Weak God's Venomancer doing a decent job here. Druid's level 4, Anti-Mage level 6, Venom level 5. So they're winning this lane pretty handily. Of course, got a bit of an advantage by taking that bear down quickly.
Yet the gold lead is about 5,000 gold lead after a tower being destroyed. I think that just shows you how far ahead that the Dire is farming.
500,
sorry.
That's a big difference.
That dumb zeros are kind of hard to read. In any case, yeah, Anti-Mage is farming so well and miles ahead of that the Lone Druid, who's only got 13 creep kills. Back in the mid lane, Sand King's creep is just out of this world as he picks up not Arcane Boots. He's going for Bottle and Urn. So he's going for the ganking Sand King. I'd like to see that, as both teams has been playing very gank-oriented lineup here. Quantic, that's the magic of Mikey. It's just...
Sadoi ganking part 3, perhaps?
Part 3. Although Sadoi now have Boots of Speed, so that's definitely very, very important to escape this gank.
He's actually just going to stand by the tower. He doesn't know where they are. He doesn't want to risk it.
Yep.
They actually do have a sentry ward there, so it's possible... the observer ward there, so he probably knows that they're sitting in the jungle wanting him. So he's just going to wait patiently, let them burn their time. He'll gladly trade his for both of theirs. Unfortunately, this is giving Korok a lot of free farm time. He's got that Aquila.
Who's that in favor of, do you think?
Do what?
That kind of trade-off. You're trading off two heroes to make sure the other hero's not getting farming, and then your Morphling gets a free farm.
Yeah, I think they're okay with that, right?
Who's okay with that?
With Quantic. They're okay with this, right?
Okay. I mean, yeah, I don't know. Is this a fair trade? I think so, but I'm not too sure. By the way, Crystal Maiden, no aura bill. I think very important point that I want out. 2 levels into that bite. The reason that he's leveling a bite is because Anti-Mage cannot blink when he's bitten. So very, very important for him to do so.
Yes. And Anti-Mage is going for the burning made famous, rather, build. Obviously, he's not the only person to ever do it. Pretty sure...
I've never seen this build before. What does it do?
Do what?
What? What's this build? He's putting one into everything!
So, generally, what he's going to be doing here is getting a lot of stats up. Oh, we see an initiation here. Nice ultimate being dropped by CRZ, taking down the Syllabaron. That's going to allow him to get this tower as well. Now, again, we see Last Hit Magic and Mikey want Sadoi to act.
Holy crap, what is this?
Insane, man. Korok is like, alright, let's do this. I think they're just trying to get kills on the Morphling. Morphling going to expose himself a bit. Sadoi perhaps knows what's up. Uh-oh.
Right,
he senses danger. He's going to run the other direction yet again. And we're going to see a nice blocker from Quark. Well played there. You're going to see a Shackle not going to catch, but CRZ TP's in. We're going to see a Burrow Strike. Last Hit Magic is going to go down, but Korok is going to get killed on Sadoi as well, and CRZ is going to be forced to use a Sandstorm, but he actually can't do a whole lot there because of the chain creep. We're going to see a wave from again, I think. You're going to see a double kill from Korok here.
He has Sandstorm coming in. No, nice Burrow Strike.
Just barely getting away.
Yep. And meanwhile, in the top lane, though, Venomancer putting up the pressure. I mean, they're using Venomancer offensively like this, and I like that a lot more. He's level 6 despite being in a dual lane. I really like his skill choice as well. Look at that.
No ulti.
Yeah, second Sting. And the reason he's not getting ulti, as we see that some first hit bash, but Solaria gets a little bit greedy. The slow slowing him down. Look at the burn so much. He's going to get the kill with the Mana Void for sure. Not, he does use it. Does get Roar under the tower. But guess what? Burning Bill says, I got stats, yo, bro. MP.
Indeed, just barely dodging the nuke from Last Hit Magic there.
As I was mentioning before all that action happened, the thing that this allows you to do is you get that very quick Vanguard, you get that quick stats, and all of a sudden you're very tanky. Now, oftentimes what you see in this build is actually skipping of the Vanguard and just going straight for a Battle Fury, and a Battle Fury plus the treads.
Ooh, Pentacle's lagging. Oh my god. And then he's gonna die now.
Oh, and he disconnected and he's gonna die. That's very unfortunate. I wonder, will Z Nation blink away and not?
No, they will not. They will not. Well, I mean, Nexus is backing up. Like, I think they would have earned the kill. Yeah, he did anyway, which I think that's a fair call.
Perhaps. I mean, he did. He ran up there and took a Venomous Gale that he might not have otherwise done, to be fair. And he has DC. Let him reconnect. Okay, so he has gone ahead and reconnected here, so we will be having a resumation. Is that a word? Resumation?
I think resume is a noun.
We will be seeing a resume. Yeah, I think it's probably right.
Damn, one-upping on Nebula. Leveling up my English, son.
I think you're right. I like resumation, though. I think that's a sweeter word. Anyway, even though I just made it up. Now, as I was going to say again about this burning build, is typically what you see is no Vanguard. You see a very quick Battle Fury, and then the stats allow you to have a lot more HP that you normally otherwise wouldn't have.
I thought you do go with the Battle Fury.
We see a nice TP in from Crystal Maiden here. We are get the kill, but it looks like Solara is going to take him down as well. So a nice rebuttal, and Mikey's going to go down as well. So maybe this doesn't... Oh, Weegod's going to get eyed in the tower, though. And so too will the Shadow Demon. So not a bad trade there, actually getting 3-for-2.
Yeah, I mean, that started out as a Beastmaster dying, right? So they're very happy with that one. Perhaps that pause is actually in the favor of Quantic, as they had all the time in the world to plan out that one.
Yeah, he actually got a magic wand there too. Use the magic wand rather to allow him to survive just long enough to force the anti-mage to dive a little bit farther than I think he wanted to. He did actually use that ultimate maybe a little aggressively on Solara when he maybe didn't have to. I mean, he did. Maybe that's a bit overstated because once he used it, he still didn't get roared, so he might have not actually got the kill or maybe would have died. So never mind on that one. But it does force him to be a bit more aggressive than he wanted to, and ends up dying there.
Oh my goodness, CRZ misses a Burrow Strike. I know that feeling where you want to be pro and you click on the ground behind him. But they're going to get the kill regardless. As I say that, there comes the Roar. Solara losing HP very rapidly. There is a bite, and that should be enough to save Solara. That misclick was absolutely huge. Instead of getting a kill on Longdruid, that wasted anti-mage farm time.
That's pretty problematic. I mean, obviously killing the Longdruid and picking up a kill on anti-mage would have been big there. But what were you actually saying about the Battle Fury?
Oh, I thought you do get the Vanguard. The burning build, apparently was a build that really is designed against a lot of physical right clickers. So good against things like a Syllabar and whatnot. And of course, Vanguard very helpful in that you get a lot of stats, so you could tank those hits. And since, as we see a little bit in jungle engagement, Nexus is gonna get his heads chopped off by that Axe Hammer guy comes in right now. But looks like the Chen has exploded. CRZ does hit that Burrow Strike. Two-man Shackle. Do we see a little bit of NS Burrow Strikes here?
No, I think we're going to see some axes cut
or,
his
or
his
NS Sandstorm.
Just wait it out Paisley before you die. Yeah, that's a bit more of what we saw there.
Yeah.
That's right. I'm sorry. I apologize. You get the Vanguard and the stats, it gives you a bunch of HP. One other thing I have seen is a lot of people who rush Battle Fury and still get the stats to make up for the fact that you're not buying any HP. But with the burning build, you're getting both to ensure you get maximum HP. That's correct.
And really, you don't need a mana break to hit creeps, because you just hit creeps anyways.
Yeah, and you gotta have a Quelling Blade. I mean, you picked up a Quelling Blade right off the bat, so it doesn't even need that.
Yeah.
Of course, Quelling Blade on Anti-Mage is a very powerful item, especially if you are going to eventually get a Battle Fury. It allows you to speed farm at such an impressive rate. I mean, it basically increases your jungling by about 32%. I mean, it's pretty ridiculous.
Yep.
Every third camp, you get a free camp, basically. That's what happens. So. It's pretty impressive there. Now, that said, Korok has been getting a lot of free farm time. While we're going to see an initiation here, he goes ahead and drops it. We're going to see an ultimate. He tries to get the morph up. He's going to take a bunch of damage. I think he's going to go down, though. Yep, and indeed, they do get that kill. So, Korok now 0-1-3. He has 3 assists. He is level 10, but Anti-Mage is level 10 as well, and he's got a kill.
Korok's actual items here, he's just got a bottle, treads, an Aquila, and no gold. Is there something on a courier for him? Yes, there's a ghost scepter on a courier. Okay.
Well, he's still on his way for his, freaking 19-minute EB.
I thought we were about to talk about how he was not going to have that. So he does have that ghost scepter, so he's still going there. Now, interestingly enough, Anti-Mage has got himself a Morbid Mask, a Ring of Regen, and a Basilius, so he's going to be rushing a Vladimir's.
Good old school Na'vi Anti-Mage, just taking your Anti-Mage into the fight, making him push a little bit more. But real fast, going back to the gank that we just witnessed on the bot lane, how many times have you lost a kill because your teammate disrupted wrong? I think we have all that, all of that experience. But what we saw there was Morphling had cooldown on his waveform, and just a bit, Roar goes off on Sadoi. They want him, as we see a Burrow Strike into a nice cancel against Nexus. And I do believe Nexus is going to be the Sacrificial Lamb. Yep, he is going to be going down. Good job by Panico by giving him the kill. But back to the point, we have Morphling's waveform on cooldown, just 2 to 3 seconds. A lot of players would have just like, oh, killed, let's disrupt, and then we'll focus him. But that would have gave enough time for Kuro to waveform out. Instead, Purge for the slow, and then a couple more right clicks with the help of his teammates. And that made a difference between getting a kill on Kurok, which is the most important hero for Quantic, and not getting a kill. So, well played here.
The amount of times my boy Tauntaun has cost me kills because of Shadow Demon pull. Just saying, shout out Tauntaun. Amazing, awesome player, one of my best Dota friends. But his Shadow Demon has cost me more than a few kills in just that exact sort of thing.
Poor
Tauntaun.
Good SD and a bad SD. Mikey perhaps saw that Crystal Maiden in that other game. Working towards it.
Indeed. What's he at here now? He's got himself some boots. So he's getting there. He's getting close. He's already got the magic one. He's about halfway there, really.
He's going to earn himself a TP scroll soon.
Yeah, so that Vlad's is completed. Now, going back to the Vlad's, I think that the reason they're getting this Vlad's is because they are against the Morphling and they are against the Sillibear. And despite the fact that Sillibear has been basically kept down, Morphling is not a hero that you can keep down forever. And at some point, he's probably going to get fat. So I think there's a good chance that they may want to use this aggression relatively soon. CRZ has got himself some Arcanes. He's about halfway to what I assume is going to be a Blink Tagger. Anti-Mage TP's middle here. And I think they're going to try and start pressuring some towers with these Vladimirs.
Pressuring all those creeps overall. Oh man, I feel bad here for Pain to go. He spent a lot of time looking for those Dark Troll Warlords. And the reason that Dark Troll Warlord is good in this case is they work the same as that Crystal Maiden net. As you cast on an Anti-Mage and he cannot blink. And that's a lot of trolls. They could have chased on the Anti-Mage, as awkward as that sound, and prevent him to do anything.
Yeah, it's almost as many trolls as a standard Dota game on DC.
There you go.
Anyway. Nexus has got himself some Arcane Boots. Not allowed to get any Shadow Poison just yet. I know when Shadow Demon first came out, a lot of people were getting poisoned, but I think most people have now identified that you got to get Disruption and Skullcatcher. It's really the reason you pick the hero. Meanwhile, he's got himself some Arcane, so that Venomancer, not completely goldless. However, the Sadoi Windrunner is completely goldless. Just phases. Is there anything on a courier for her? No, there's actually nothing, so she is very weak right now.
Of course, whenever you're starting those escape...
Uh-oh, Korok versus Anti-Mage, here we go. The big battle, looks like Winter... Ooh, Morphling is going to be able to get away. Going to bottle up here. Solar needs to be careful. He doesn't want to catch any kind of second waveforms. We've got 4 seconds away. Oh, he's actually going to walk in and get a bunch of burn. Looks like he'll blink away. Whew! That was a standoff. Neither wanting to stand down.
Well, Anti-Mage chickened out. I was looking at Tom when you called that one out, so I missed the first blows of that fight. Of course, we're going to see a lot more of that. Uh-oh, Morphling sees a Shadow Demon, and he is going to just wave. Cool.
Just wave right past him. And actually, Painted Gold comes up now. They probably could have got that kill if he'd have been a little bit more patient. Burrow Strike catches the Mikey here, but he is going to get netted, and a similar problem. He's got nowhere to go. Disruption does cancel that, but it looks like Nexus is going to go down immediately, just gets blown away. Morphling picking up that kill. Anti-Mage did get a tower, but he lost 2 teammates in the process, so... Not necessarily a good trade. He does TP up top. He wants to maybe go after the Sillibear. Not going to be able to do so. Sadoi, they're taking a bunch of damage off of that bear. And Stallioner is going to continue his farm. He's looking to get himself a Yasha.
Kurok sees the Morph, or sees the Venomancer, and Adaptic Strike, not going to be enough. And that's where the Venomancer scale is fairly useful, slowing down Kurok from getting the last necessary right click. But unfortunately, that is not going to last a long time, as Kurok not too far, as he lasted that tower. from that EB.
1,400 gold.
We're not going to see that 19-minute EB, but it still is going to be in a pretty good time.
Yeah, he's 2-1-3. He's level 12 relative to the Z Nation teams. Level 7, level 8, level 10, level 8. Just the Anti-Mage is actually keeping up with him, which is to be expected as they are like carries. That said, Silibear is also level 11, and Beastmaster is level 11. So despite what it appears, and I feel like for most of this, I felt like Z Nation is in the lead, but they're actually down in kills and XP as we're at a, what about, 2,500 gold or XP advantage for the Radiant, and the gold is basically completely...
What? Waiting for that adjective. Top tower is
under attack. What?
What? The goal is basically what?
Completely even.
Oh.
You didn't hear that?
And perhaps it cut off. I was waited with bated breath on that last term. Unfortunately, never
Except heard you
it.
Were talking, so you weren't, you liar. Anyway, in middle, Painted Gold's got himself a Hood of Defiance to go with those boots, so he's a little bit more tanky, can survive a bit more of that magical damage, which there is so much. Meanwhile, Antimage is trying to just A-click Roshan. He does have the Vlads, which will allow him to do this a bit more effectively, though he's still going to need some amount of team support. He can't do this by himself, though he appears to think he can. Oh, maybe he can, actually. One Vinnil Ward maybe is going to create enough attack power to maybe take this down.
Antimage, he can do this. Antimage and Vinnil Ward against the world.
Yeah, and actually Roshan just bashed him about 5 times in a row. I think Antimage very frustratedly blinked away. I think he could have got that if not for all those massive amounts of bashes. And actually, Quantic now knows what's up. They see that Roshan is at half HP. He didn't get there alone. Roshan was not being attacked by neutrals. They're going to go right after the Antimage. He does get initiated on. We see an immediate roar on SK, but the disruption very well placed there. And we see a waveform actually doesn't do it, but he does manage to pick him up on just a right click there. Meanwhile, Antimage getting very low on HP, and he gets Frostbitten again. Down he will go. We see the tornado slowing Weak God down just enough, and he's going to do it, as well as Silibear picking up a double kill there. Ooh, and now up to 3.9k, which means the relic is about to be completed, but is Korok going to go down? Yes, he will. Power shot from Shadoi. Man, just gets in there. Mike is going to be the next one to fall. Is he going to die? Yes, he will go down to one last attack there, so you see a triple kill for Windrunner. So despite her early game failures, now going to be pretty close to that mechanism.
Satoy's, that said, Satoy saying, who is starting those escape adventure now? CRZ buys back for that engagement. He did die in the middle of it. And we do have a counter buyback from Morphling. That is going to slow down his, the Adira Blade. And in rage, He kills the melee creep.
Yeah, he wanted to get that kill, but a Shackle Shot prevented that from happening. And nothing after that TP, or that buyback in TP, which cost him, what was the buyback? About 650 gold there. So plus the TP, about almost 800 gold invested for nothing. He's going to give himself a little bit of farm time, but that's not going to make back anything. That said, Solara is at 4.1k, so we are going to see a Radiance in the near future.
Yeah, let's quickly check out what we have. Ooh, I'm going to answer the phone, so you can check out what
Boom,
we have.
Boom, I'll do it. So on Beastmaster, we have, of course, the Hood of Defiance with the boots and that bottle. I can't actually tell what his gold is. I'm going to click on it real fast. He's rocking about 900 gold. Mikey, meanwhile, just the phases, so pretty decent move speed on Crystal Maiden, and another 140 gold, so nothing really there. Chenny Wall has got herself the Arcanes and a Mecha, as well as a Basilius and just a little smoke action, and another 160 gold there, so not a whole lot. Of course, Korok with those treads, the bottle, and the Aquila with that Ghost Scepter, just 1,900 gold, of course, spending, as I said, that 800 right now, so he would have been at 2,700 gold if he hadn't spent that, and would have pretty much been Ethereal Blade, which obviously would have been pretty important. And as I mentioned, 4.1k on a Lone Druid. I'm actually going to go ahead and check out what his bear has. Where's the bear? There's the bear. The bear has just Stout Shield, so there's not a whole lot more gold actually there. Anti-Mage, meanwhile, of course, has the Yasha, the Vlads, that Vanguard, as well as the Treads, and just 140 gold himself. Windrunner, meanwhile, just 33 gold, but does have now completed that mechanism on the back of that triple kill, as well as the phases. Blink Dagger almost done on Sand King. He's at 1.8k. He does have that bottle, Urn, and the Arcanes himself. Shadow Demon, meanwhile, has got Arcanes and not a whole lot else. He's about 360 gold, but he has the just about primary support here. Venomancer, the actual support, has Arcanes and Bracer, and about 200 gold there. So I would say the item advantage is still in Quantic's favor, is that Radiance is, again, we're at 4.1k on the Lone Druid. Morphling, despite, I think Korok would very much like to have that buyback. Buyout back, as he would be at 2,700 gold and so close to that Ethereal Blade. You hear? You just lie to me? I heard a bunch of noises and then you bailed. Alright. Well, we are still paused here. 13-11, the advantage currently in Quantic. We are in game number 3 of the first round match between Quantic and Z Nation. This is, of course, for the West qualifier for the international wild card spot. For those of you who don't know, there is a wild card spot for the international two of them, the East one and the West one. Of course, Quantic and Z Nation both using Morphling, a pretty strong effect here. First game, we saw Quark's Morphling get fat very quick and carry the game. And then in game 2, we saw Z Nation, CRZ's Morphling get pretty fat and take that game. And then in game 3, I was questioning whether or not Morphling would just be insta first pick, and it was not. But they did go ahead and pick it up here nonetheless. So Morphling kind of the tail of the tape in this series.
I'm now back. Hopefully we're okay. So I assume you discussed the kind of the awkward. I would
every single hero's picks, or every single hero's items, and of course, as I mentioned, if Korok had not bought out, he'd be at 2,700 gold right now.
Yep.
So he'd basically be on the Ethereal Blade. But now,
I mean, you can't really fault Korok for buying out. He is an aggressive player by nature.
Yeah, and he thought he was going to get a kill for sure. And unfortunately, the Shackle Shot really prevented him from doing so. Is that stopped that? His teammate from getting any kind of stun there or slow for him. Unless we're going to have a resume here. And, so another Dark Troll has been picked up from Last Hit Magic. Korok very generously leaving it for him, opting not to Last Hit it.
You know what resume reads as? Resume.
What? No. Resume has a little...
I know it does, but... Right. Sorry, I just had a discovery.
A brainwave?
Yeah.
Flash of insight, if you will.
Yeah, man.
A flash of insight is actually maybe a Diablo skill, not sure. So the relic gets purchased by Solari. He's going to get sent back to base by Last Hit, just to, region up a little bit and getting closer to that Radiance. I think, I'm pretty sure, Anti-Mage at that 560 gold at Yasha, they're pretty close to wanting to go for this, right? Like, they can't turtle this out too much. I mean, that Radiance is going to make it pretty difficult for them.
Here's the thing, I don't feel like Anti-Mage by himself is tanky enough. I think they need that Aegis. They just will need it to win the fight.
Yeah, and they're trying to do just that, as we see Staliner yet again jumping right into that Roshan pit. His damage output with the Vladimir allows him to obviously tank enough and survive, like lifesteal enough to take that. Again, we see Quantic not allowing that to happen. We're going to see Aurora here. Ooh, he tried to cast it, not going to get it. Instead, he's going to get Aurora on Nexus. And I think Korok will be more than happy to just assassinate him, as he does very quickly there. Staliner gets Frostbitten here, and we're going to get down goes the Anti-Mage. CRZ hits a big epicenter blink and burrow strike, but it doesn't actually kill anybody. Hand of God saving everybody. We see a Venomancer ulti being dropped. It looks like CRZ is going to do the NS dodge, which is a...
He's moving. He's got it.
He used his right click to run away. Shocking.
NS dodge part 2.
He's forgotten sending chapter. Us a message about how to run away after using Sandstorm.
But regardless,
Korok is going to try to take the Roshan here. He's at 3.1k on the back of that kill, so if they get this Roshan, he will actually have the Ethereal Blade as well as the Aegis, and then he's going to wait for him up there.
I think that team fight just turned the game around. So Doi try and run. Now she is starting the the escape adventures. This game has so many backstab ganks; it's not even funny. But we're finally going to see some tower pushing. Just again, how this entire series has been, the losing team never breached tier 2. I mean, look at Quantic's tier 2 right now. I think that's a sign that, it might be really early to call it right now, but Z Nation seems to lose this game.
Look, we're at 23 and a half minutes in. There's an Ethereal Blade, an Aegis, and Treads, and Aquila on the Morphling, along with that bottle, of course. It doesn't sound like a lot until you look at the Syllabar and realize he has a Radiance.
Yep.
The Radiance is now completed. It's currently in his stash. It's going to be transferred to him relatively quickly. We're looking at a pretty solid advantage for Quantic here. That battle was big time. They not only did they get the Roshan, but they picked off the Anti-Mage. They took down a number of heroes on the dire side and didn't lose anybody. That could have even been even worse for the dire. CRZ just barely managed to survive there. So, yeah, it's not looking very good, and it looks like Morphling may be winning every single one of these games.
Morphling also won that game in the Mouse versus Infuse series, correct?
Yes. And he was quite fat as well, as was the Invoker. That game, I just caught the tail end of it there. Sing Sing had a very fat Invoker. Mal's Black had a very fat Morphling. I assume Bamboo's Furion had absolutely nothing, because he's kind of garbage. But nonetheless, Mal's managed to win despite him. Much love to Bamboo, by the way. We're, of course, good friends with him. That's a completely not a direct flame, of course, although it is. Mal will be Mal's will be, hopefully we'll cast those replays, perhaps off, sometime later tonight or something. Maybe we'll see those on YouTube. Maybe not.
Maybe not. We'll see.
Either way, they're up somewhere. Plenty of people casted them, I'm sure. So if you miss those games, go check them out.
Yep. As I say, that's Z Nation struggling to get those Tier 2. They got a Tier 2. And looks like they have a smoke back, or anti-mage has ported back, and the rest of the team is smoking, trying to get off a pickoff. Meanwhile, the other side, thinking of the exact same thing. Here comes the Beastmaster Roar. It's coming right now. There's a Roar. They got a chainsaw on this one perfectly. Where's the EB? No EB. Just no EB for the last hit, because he didn't want to lose the physical damage from his teammates. Gank done correctly.
Yeah, and he used his adaptive strike to buy him just enough mini stun time, really, to allow them to get enough last hits in there to steal a Ethereal Blade to cut him down. That was really well played from Korok.
Yeah.
And I think Korok is really exhibiting in this series just why I personally think he's the best Morphling player in the world. I don't know that for sure. I mean, I've never seen Dindy play Morphling or anything, but Korok has played him to pretty amazing effect in many, many, many games in the over the years.
Well, I'm not sure whether he's going to get the best Morphling award as...
Well, there is the... Yeah,
I mean, there's Burning, but then there's... Yeah, they also play Burning. A very different, distinct playstyle.
Silvercross as well, I think, plays a very strong Morphling. So there's
the Kells. The Kells.
Yeah, there's a number of great Morphling players out there. So. I personally like Korok's Morphling just because of how aggressive it is at all times. We actually all deny the dire melee bears.
300 gold, 300 gold, boy.
Hey, 300 gold, yeah, I guess. They did get the melees, the ranges are pretty low. That bear with that radiance, phases on the bear as well. You're going to send back Solara yet again. Nice use of the TP's back here from Last Hit Magic.
Oh, they're going to kill that bear.
I'm pretty sure he's just gonna blink it, right?
No, you can't blink it if it's taking damage.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that change. Yeah. Big changes. Meanwhile, Korok has a replicate somewhere. No, he doesn't have a replicate, but he's gonna go ahead and assassinate Shadow Demon nonetheless. Oh, he does have one. Okay.
I was looking at the meme. I was like, oh. Okay.
I didn't see it anywhere, but he does go ahead and pop that. I guess I could have checked by the mana cost. Of course, it only costs 25 when you're casting it the first time, and 150 when you're actually going to use the replicate. I see a lot of Morphlings try and cast the replicate and realize they don't have any mana to actually get to it. So you gotta do the math before you jump up there, which is, of course, we see again switching those power trades every time he waveforms. Korok being just, meticulous with his Morphling mana usage here.
Switch your treads, don't be mana waster, because on a hero like Morphling, every drop of mana is like gold to him. I mean, he has four active skill, if you think about it. And he has to, wave, or it seems he has to support his teleport scroll, Ethereal Blade, all that stuff. So.
And they're expensive. I mean, more waveform costs 165, adaptive strike is 100, replicate plus using it is 175, and morph when you need it usually takes all of your mana.
There you go.
And you're usually shifting 78 agility over to strength, which costs quite a bit. So his morph is, his mana is incredibly important, especially against an anti-mage, who at any moment can burn out a pretty hefty sum of it. Now that said,
I mean, casting both games of Korok's Morphling, I have not said, oh man, he's out of mana for a waveform. I don't think I've said that once. And
yeah,
I think that's a sign of a good Morphling player.
He's going to go ahead and TP back to base here. He picked himself up a bottle, or back to double damage room in his bottle. He also has a point booster, an orb of venom. He picked up an ultimate orb. That's going to be a Scotty. Korok, not opting to get the Mance style this time. Just going to want jump right into the Scotty this time as... Yeah, it's a very strong item, of course, on a Morphling. All of the stats matter. Again, against that anti-mage, that extra intelligence off the back of the... Or the extra mana off the point boost and extra intelligence off that ultimate order is going to be pretty important here. Meanwhile, anti-mage is going to try and right-click this tower. I think he's actually going to get it. We're going to see a roar. Oh, nice! Manta blink away, just causing that... obviously, the animation from blink is a little bit longer than the Manta animation, so by using the Manta first, he bought just enough time to allow himself to blink, which, of course, canceled the roar. So,
yeah, the blink has a 0.3 casting animation. That would have been enough time. Pentagol was raising his arm to get the cough.
Yeah.
Manta, of course, debuffed the command. And actually, I think if he died there, they were going to get the mid-rax down. Because
I think they would have won the game. Yeah, definitely. He doesn't have all the buyout.
Quantic, very, very strong pushing as Spiritbird now has a Hyperstone on top of that. Korok slowly joining. Has a double damage. I mean, this is one of the benefits of having a bottle you carry, especially throughout the late game. There's so many runes that just changes high team fight. I think in game number one, we saw Morphling, right? He got initiated on, he just right-clicked, and he just killed everybody, so.
Yeah, we've talked about that before, of course, the power of the carry bottle.
Yeah.
It's a pretty big deal. And I think you've even theory crafted in the past that that Kerry should maybe pick up a bottle later on. Anyway, we do see I immediately just walk up the tower here. The Syllabary did massive damage. Krog just A-clicking. He is taking a bunch of damage. He waited for him, but actually doesn't get far enough away. He's forced to adapt to strike. He's going to start waveforming. We see a Hand of God from Chin, so all are healed. That melee rack's taking a bunch of damage. Krog is going to lose that Aegis, but it's okay. He's going to regen up. Mikey taking a bunch of damage here. He is going to go down. There's a gem there, actually. Krog just assassinates the Venomancer. He's going to go ahead and A-click the Antimage, who does get roared here. He's got a lot of survivability, but I think he's just going to be able to get away there. That said, they will probably... Ooh, actually, CRZ hitting nobody with that Epicenter.
Okay,
now they're just going to easily get their melee racks.
Hold up. Parts of my body are hard. Korok waveform. He saw the Sand King channeling his ultimate. Waveforming, cancel this. Keep on attacking Anti-Mage. Cancel the ultimate from Sand King. And just still went on the Anti-Mage. And he's just basically one person stopped three people. Kind of insane play.
Yeah, and in fact, he TP's back to base. He's going to be able to come back full HP here. He's going to go ahead and shotgun down the CRZ. He actually doesn't die to that, and actually he's going to cost for it now. So his big players are going to kind of rebuttal here, and he's going to get assassinated, I'm pretty sure. We see a Shackle Shot slowing him down a bit. He's still surviving. And in fact, Chen's going to send him back to base, and he managed to survive. Well played from Last Hit Magic there. So we were talking about how Korok is playing well. Last Hit Magic doing a nice job there, managing to save him. CRZ just barely surviving there. So he's taking a bunch of damage here, and it looks like Mikey's going to be the next one to fall. A Hatchel Shot. Kind of going right, catching in there, Antimage picks up the kill. CRZ, 30 HP right now.
Whoa! Oh my god, the dude with the cup!
Dude with the cup! He's gonna hit
Visibility.
Oh. Nigga be rolling around with that cup, drinking a brew. Dude, to get a kill,
the dude with the cup almost had him. That would have been sick play.
Oh, I have never seen anybody die to the bro with the cup.
People should die with the bro with the cup.
Business. People roll up and kill him all the time. He would have got a little bit of anti-mage action there. That'd have been big time.
Dude.
Of course, he only does 14 damage. You would have hit him like three times.
A dude with a cup is a swag master. Come on.
CRZ actually is who he's going for, not the anti-mage. My apologies. That said, 14 damage, not exactly known for his last hitting potential.
No, definitely not.
But that speed are a pretty big deal. 12% move speed, giving a little bit of 39 extra damage here. Move speed. Roshan is up in about 45 seconds. It looks like probably Quantica realized that. I'm going to gather here, probably try and get Korok himself a another Aegis, and maybe in this game. He has finished that Scott. He's got another 1,600 gold. Oh, we see a pause here from CRZ.
Game's over, right?
Yes. And in fact, CRZ rage quits. Just kidding. Of course, is reconnecting. I assume he had some kind of bug. Maybe he had the bug of, oh my god, I'm getting chased by a bro with a cup and I might die.
That is an insane bug. Bigger and better than Weaver.
If you ever die
to a bro with a cup,
with a bro with a cup, I will never let you live it down, ever. In fact, I may start playing Chin just so I can convert cup guys. I'm gonna roll around.
They should change the name of that scream. Bro with a cup, man.
Cobalt Taskmaster, what now? The bro with the cup.
Man.
He's rolling around the jungle. He's just drinking a brew. People come up, kill him all the time. He's like, man, what? I'm trying to what the hell? You know?
Everyone's just disrespecting that creep camp, man.
And look at it. I'd like to point out, look at his necklace. All right, click on.
Where is he right now?
He's next to Mikey on the between purple and the teal there.
Okay.
Bro has a chain, a gold necklace. Like, who designed this creep? I want to give him a medal because he is the king Dota developer. All right.
I think that creep should be the only creep that you could get an item from. He would get his item would be a pair of sunglasses, right?
Yeah.
Just have that on top.
You should be able to buy a backpack item where if you convert that unit, he just grows some, you get some glasses.
Dude, that would be sick, bro. Get some shades. Oh.
Greatest unit in all of the Dota map. Look at it. Did you see that? Take a swag drink. His team is fighting. He doesn't even care. Just throws one back while he's killing some jungle creeps.
All right, go. You cast right now.
All right, so Korok actually assassinates a creep here. We're waiting for the Roshan, who is now resurrected. Z Nation apparently identifies that. They're going to go ahead and smoke up here just to latch this effort to try and catch anybody, anything. anything they can do to prolong this game is they have no top racks. Top racks is actually being pressured now from those creeps. Have no middle racks. Middle racks pretty close to being pressured, so they can't even really fight it out over this Roshan. And Quantic very wisely is going to back up and kind of force CRZ to go up there and do a little defending. They now see that he is up there on the map, which means Warrock is being a bit aggressive here, I think.
He has no Lincolns. He's very killable at this point, especially with the damage output from Anti-Mage. It's really no joke, and especially with the Manta style. You got to keep in mind that melee creeps do mono burn, but, well...
In a related story, he's also highly kill-effective. He has 237 damage and, of course, about 4K shotgun. I mean, it's not that much, but it's a lot. And just immediately assassinated CRZ. Now they're going to take that Roshan and I think, in the game.
Yep.
Right? Wow, he's actually waveformed up. Okay, so we were talking about how he was very good with his mana efficiency. Just burned it to pick it up. Like, was he expecting Anti-Mage to blink down there and take it?
He might not, you know.
Perhaps. Perhaps. All right, I'll give you that. Perhaps that was a cautious play.
Cautious play indeed. In any case.
Looks like they see an invisibility rune on bottom. Croc going to go bottle that. Actually, he doesn't have his bottle anymore. He sold it.
I think for 300 gold. Not too
finished
sure.
Finish the Scotty, perhaps? I'm not sure when he sold that. He is going to go ahead and grab it eventually. Maybe. Oh, there's a bottle. Okay, he's making a replicate and then going to crack it. Okay, so he wants a replicate. Obviously, when you cast replicate while invisible, it's no longer going to. You're going to be not visible anymore. So. He wanted to get a replicate.
That was almost as smart as when you said 5v4, Teamless 5 has advantage.
Yeah. Well, that's not always the case. I think right now, if they lost to Crystal Man, they'd be 5v4 and still have the advantage. Now, what he's going to do is he's going to assassinate whoever he can find. Probably going to be the Shadow Demon. Yep. No, he almost missed it. And he goes ahead and uses that ultimate, of course, to just get back there. So now it's a 5v4 advantage, which, of course, does favor Quantic.
Although,
to see a roar on Antimage. Uh-oh. Yep, GG. CRZ, it's a big ultimate, manages to take nobody down, actually. So never mind.
Z Nation is fighting so hard right now. As much as or someone joking about this game, Solin blinks and that's gonna be it. And for the game, Quantic is gonna be advancing to the winner bracket. Z Nation is fighting so hard, they're making all the smart plays, saving for buybacks. But 1-2 pick off, 1-2 many here and there. Anti-Mage got picked off twice, and I think that's when they lost the top racks. Quantic's Morphling, or Morphling in general, just 2 damage drop.
Yeah, and we get a GG out here. Shout out to Daisy from Solara and Quant. Yeah, they're going to continue on. Now, going back to my previous point, wow, just big shout outs from Mikey here all game. Just wanted to shout out to every one of his homeboys. I want to point out, we've noticed Quantic has been picking this Morphling. They've been very much based upon the carry. They've 100% been a carry based team. They pick Morphling, or they pick Storm Spirit, they pick Scyllabar, etc. They get that fat, and then they win the game. Against a team like MTW, or against a team like Infused or Mouse, can they do that? Those teams are much more aggressive and much more disciplined when it comes to pushing. They will take your towers, and I wonder, going forward in this qualifier, how will Quantic do?
I mean,
will they be able to counteract that?
I feel like Quantic play the way they did is because Z Nation was a team that played similarly. I mean, if you look at what Mikey and Last Minute Magic are doing, they actually are ganking very aggressively. They're helping Morphling push. And then once they get the advantage on Morphling side, well, there's nothing much to do because they don't need to. So I think we're seeing one side of Quantic, and we're probably going to see another side of Quantic when the situation calls for it. And hey, if the strategy's been working, then no need to change it.
Yeah, I mean, Quantic, I disagree. I think Quantic has just been playing this style and this style only for a little while now. And I'm interested to see if it's going to work against, you know, the better teams in the group. No offense to Z Nation. They played very well and took down game two pretty handily and easily could have won that game with just a little bit different timing kills on the Anti-Mage as far as the Korok getting fat. So, you know, no offense to Z Nation, but I wonder how it's going to work against a team like Mouse or MTW. So we'll see. We'll see.
All right. That's
of course,
gonna...
MTW are actually in the loser bracket, right?
I can't remember. MTW is in the loser bracket. VP took game number 3. Somewhat convincing fashion. A little update on the Mouse Infused series. Game 2 is done soon, according to Holy Master. Game 3 incoming most likely.
Ooh, so Infused perhaps evening that one up, huh?
So Nebula, you're staying up, or you're going to just crash right now?
Let's cast game 3, bro.
I like that. I like that. All right, we're going to just chill around and wait for game number 3. So we have one last game coming your way. Don't go anywhere, guys. And I can see dudes with the cup on the comments. people are appreciating that creep as much as we are. I mean, come on, best creep in Dota?
Easily.